We're selling spice, doing spice, bathing in spice. Give me the spice! That's right, it's Dune Imperium from Direwolf Digital. In this spice-spending, deck-building, worker-placement game of faction intrigue and combat, 1 to 4 players take on the role of leaders from great houses of Arrakis. With a little diplomacy, reconnaissance, and some strategic warfare, one player will rise above the others in a race for victory points. At the end of a round where a player has at least 10 points, the player with the most points wins the game. Today we're setting up for a 3 or 4 player game. There's additional setup for 1 and 2 player games, which include an automated faction leader. Check out the bonus rulebook for details. Setup begins with the game board placed center. Set the alliance markers on the faction influence tracks along the left side. Emperor, Spacing Guild, Bene Gesserit, and the Fremen. Shuffle and place the Intrigue deck next to the Influence track. Shuffle and place the Imperium deck along the top of the board and reveal the top 5 cards in a row to the right. Next to that row, place the 3 stacks of reserve cards, Arrakis Liaison, The Spice Must Flow, and Fold Space. Place the Mintat on the Mintat space and create a supply nearby for all the tokens, Spice, Water, and Solari. Next, each player takes a leader. Leaders have a name and complexity level, house, passive ability, and signet ability. They place their leader in front of them along with 1 water, which forms the beginning of their personal supply area. Additionally, they take the following of 1 color, 3 agents, 2 onto their leader, and 1 next to the game board. 2 discs, one of which goes on the 0 space of the scoring track, or in a 4-player game, on the 1 space. A combat marker, which goes on the 0 space of the combat track. 16 cubes, 4 of which go on a bottom space of each of the influence tracks, and 3 of which go on one of the garrison spaces. And 3 control markers, which they collect with the leftover cubes and disc into their personal supply. Each player also forms their personal deck of cards with the starting configuration. 2 convincing arguments, 2 daggers, 2 Dune the Desert planets, and 1 of each of diplomacy, reconnaissance, seek allies, and signet ring. Each of these cards has a starting symbol in the top left for reference. Players now shuffle their personal deck and set it face down next to their leader. Randomly select the first player and give them the first player marker. Finally, create the conflict deck. First, separate and shuffle the conflict cards by their level, 1, 2, and 3. Then create a deck by dealing face down 4 conflict 3 cards, 5 conflict 2 cards, and 1 conflict 1 card to form a 10 card deck. Place the conflict deck above the round order guide on the board. Gameplay occurs in rounds, each divided into 5 phases. Round start, player turns, combat, makers, and recall. First up in round start, the top card of the conflict deck is revealed and placed face up to the right. Each player then draws 5 cards from their personal deck to form their hand. Next, in the player turns phase, beginning with the player who holds the first player marker and proceeding clockwise, each player will take a turn, either an agent turn or a reveal turn. After a player takes their reveal turn, they are out of rotation for the remainder of the phase. The player turns phase lasts until all players are out of rotation. Let's look at the turn types. On an agent turn, the active player will play a card from their hand face up into their personal area. They then take 1 of their agents from their leader card and place them on an open space on the board. This space must have an icon in its upper left corner that matches an icon on the played card. Cards have name and sometimes faction, agent icons, persuasion cost, an agent box, and a reveal box. When playing an agent turn, the active player plays the card, moves the agent to a space, then gains the effect on the space as well as the effects on the agent box of the card. They may then take them in any order, but they must pay any costs on spaces in order to place an agent there. Any effects with an arrow are also a cost, but if the player chooses not to pay, they simply don't gain that effect. Before we talk about the spaces, let's review the agent icons. Emperor, Spacing Guild, Bene Gesserit, Fremen, Landsrad, City, and Spice Trade. Each of these icons corresponds to an area of the board with spaces available for agents to access. Let's review some of these spaces. Conspire and Wealth. These Emperor spaces, like all faction spaces, first allow a player who moved their agent there to gain a faction level, moving their cube one space on that track. Wealth is free to place, and the player gains 2 Solari, while Conspire costs 2 spice, but gives the player 5 Solari, 2 troops, and an intrigue card. So, you know, is anything free, really? The Landsrad spaces all have a Solari cost, except the Hall of Oratory, where the player will gain various rewards, including some important ones, like the Mentat figure, which acts as a bonus agent this round, or the High Council seats, which allow a player to gain a permanent persuasion bonus on their reveal turn. Another key space, the Swordmaster, costs 8 Solari, but allows a player to gain their third agent for the rest of the game. The populated areas of Dune and its deserts are important locations for combat and represent the main military conflicts in the game. Any space on the board with a combat symbol is also considered a combat space, and the player may recruit troops onto the board. For each cube symbol, they may place 1 troop from their supply to their garrison. Additionally, anytime they use a combat space, they may place any or all troops recruited that turn to the conflict area in the center, plus up to 2 more troops from their garrison. More on how combat works in the next phase. Many other spaces on the board allow players to gain influence with factions, trade resources for other resources, or flat out gain massive benefits. The spice harvesting spaces also provide cumulative spice benefits if players haven't placed agents there recently. Check out the board space guide for all the intricacies. When a player either has run out of agents for an agent turn or chooses to end early, they take their reveal turn. This is when they reveal all the remaining cards in their hand and resolve the reveal effects on those cards, many of which include persuasion. This is used to sway cards from the Imperium row or the reserve into a player's discard pile. Once they need to draw cards but have none remaining in their deck, the discard is shuffled to form a new deck, incorporating those new cards. To complete their reveal turn, a player sets their combat strength by moving their conflict marker to their calculated score. They get 2 points for each troop in the conflict area and 1 point for every sword icon revealed. A player must have a troop in the conflict to have any combat strength in this step. Troops in the garrison are not considered part of the conflict. Finally, they clean up by removing their cards from their play area to the discard. Next, in the combat phase, players duke it out. Starting with the player who holds the first player marker and proceeding in turn order, each player with troops in the conflict may play combat intrigue cards, or pass. Once all players have passed consecutively, conflict is then resolved, and players win awards listed on the current conflict card based on their strength. The first place player gains the top benefits and second gains the middle benefits. Only in a 4-player game does someone get the rewards for third place. Next, in the Makers phase, any of the spaces on the board with Maker icons that are currently empty of agents gain 1 spice from the supply onto that spot. The next player to access that space gains a little bonus spice. Finally, in the Recall phase, if no player has at least 10 points, the Mentat is returned to its space, players recall their agents to their leader card, and the first player marker passes clockwise. Some other key mechanics of the game you're going to want to know about. intrigue cards. Most of these action cards may be played to gain a benefit, either resources during an agent or reveal turn, combat bonuses during combat, or in-game points in the endgame. Faction tracks. Placing an agent in the spaces corresponding to factions allow players to move up those tracks. When any player hits the second space of a faction, they gain a point. The first player to reach the Alliance level, marked with a line, gains the faction token and a point. However, if another player then passes them on the track, or if they go below the line, they'll lose the token. Control bonuses. Some conflict cards give players control over a space of Dune if they win the combat. That player gains a control marker to that space, and anytime any agent is placed there, that player gains the bonus. Gameplay continues with players duking it out for control of Arrakis. At the end of a round where at least one player has 10 points, the player with the most points wins. And that's the basics of Dune Imperium. A few specifics exist for smaller player counts, including AI factions, and a number of additional leaders for each of the houses. I'm Becca Scott, this is Good Time Society, and if you love spice as much as I do, give this video a like, subscribe to our channel, and follow us on social media. If you do, you'll receive a voucher for 5 Solari off your next spice purchase. See you later!